Hey there, one and all, and welcome to the first proper installment of DirectorQuest! If you missed the intro to this series, click the link in the video description to go back and hear about why I think studying great directors is the business. Otherwise, I think we are about ready to dive straight in with the first leg of our journey, KubrickQuest. From his humble beginnings to celebrated success, and then, unfortunately, a far too early end, we're gonna follow the thread of Stanley Kubrick's life and career one film at a time, and we'll see what we can glean from that as we go. Which settings and characters tickle his fancy, which themes and worldviews he likes to espouse, and how he builds his personal style from film to film. And when we're done, we will hopefully end up with a pretty useful picture of which of his films you should see for sure, and which you can safely skip in favor of other things in your to-watch pile. Alright, so, before we take on our first film, I want to get into a little bit of background stuff first. See, apart from the fact that Stanley Kubrick is just this hugely famous director whose work I feel I really haven't seen enough of, the big reason I chose to kick off this series with him is that he is traditionally held up as a textbook example of what film people like to call an auteur. Auteur theory is kind of complicated, but basic idea is that among all the people who work on a movie, the director is the strongest voice contributing to its creation, and thus he or she has the most right to be called its author. The director interprets the script, decides on the overall style and approach of the project, and they generally have the final say on everyone else's contribution, so you can see where the idea comes from. Of course, there are arguments against it, mainly that it minimizes contributions from screenwriters, cinematographers, producers, actors, what have you. But on the whole, the idea still holds true in that certain directors do have stylistic or thematic tendencies that show very strongly in all their works. Directors that show these tendencies are called auteurs, after the French word for author, because why would you say author when you can be all fancy and a French instead? Oh, ho, ho, ho. Anyway, that brings us to the big question of the season. What exactly makes Stanley Kubrick an auteur?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I have some ideas. I have some ideas based on the few things I already know about him. But if I already knew the whole answer, we wouldn't be trying to find out together like this, now would we?
So in order to work towards that answer, let's start at the very beginning. A very good place to start. Stanley Kubrick was born and grew up in New York. He was quiet, he loved reading, chess, boxing, photography, and he absolutely loathed school. So naturally, he skipped a lot, and while he was skipping, he ended up going to see a lot of movies. An interest which continued as he moved into a career in photography in his late teens and early 20s. He developed a great appreciation for directors such as Ilya Kazan, the great actor's director.
You don't understand, I could have had class. I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody.
Max Ophüls, a German director known for his smooth, complex camera work.
Le paysan disait, c'est un bon métier. Et il envoyait son enfant tenir un harem de filles comme il l'eût envoyé diriger un pensionnat de demoiselles.
And Sergei Eisenstein, the seminal Soviet director and father of montage. The final battle in Eisenstein's film Alexander Nevsky was especially influential on Kubrick's first idea for a feature film, Fear and Desire, a war story about a group of soldiers whose plane crashes, stranding them behind enemy lines, and forcing them to do whatever it takes to survive and continue fighting their enemies. But are they really fighting their enemy? Or simply the darkness that lies in the hearts of all mankind? Kubrick calculated that if he played his cards right, he could make his movie for under $10,000 and do it just as well, if not better, than any given drivel Hollywood was pushing out week to week at the time. So, in 1952, at the young age of 24, and with some significant financial help from his uncle and father, lucky son of a bitch, Kubrick eventually managed to take a cast and crew of 14 people into the mountains of California, and they made their movie. So here's the thing about Fear and Desire. It's an impressive first film, but it's still very much just that. A first film. Don't get me wrong, it's very ambitious. Lots of careful composition, dolly shots, and mood lighting that's very nice to look at a lot of the time. But what nice moments there are really aren't enough to distract from the fact that just about everyone involved is clearly still getting their sea legs.
movie legs. Whatever.
Should we make sure it floats?
Rafts always float.
Kubrick had gained some experience prior to this with a few documentary shorts, notably the well-received Day of the Fight, but a feature-length fiction film is a whole different beast from, say, a 16-minute short that just involves following people around with cameras. Kubrick really didn't know much about directing actors for film, and it shows. Everyone in the cast tends to be operating in one of two modes at any given time. Boring B. Boringson.
We're in a fine mess now.
I admit that our prospects aren't very cheerful.
Or Hammy J. McScenery Chewing.
It wasn't my fault. The magician did it. Honest. Prospero the magician. Before I was a general. And now I'm a fish. Hurrah for the magicians!
The one lucky exception is Frank Silvera as Sergeant Mac, the requisite cynic within the group of soldiers.
Your computations. With your brilliant figuring that got us in the first place.
Out of all the major players, he seems to be the only one who can conjure up a halfway believable personality. Corny dialogue aside.
Here I am. I'm 34 years old. I've never done anything important. Nothing. When this is over, I'll fix radios and washing machines, and they'll say,
good boy, Mac. That's all.
His inner monologues later in the film are particularly good, and they raise him just a little bit above the limits of his archetype.
Oh, they'll get him soon. A duck and a shooting gallery. And I'll be the wheel under all the ducks and all the bullseyes. I should talk. The clay pigeon on a slow raft.
Compare that to the other characters who can essentially be summed up as all-American leader guy.
I'm quite sure she wasn't educated abroad. You, sea, boat, our, boat.
Naive, idealistic guy who is clearly only in the movie to go crazy and show the dark heart of mankind.
The river. It's blood, Mac.
And other guy?
Well, it's not that I want to seem important.
Oh, and nameless girl who gets sexually assaulted and murdered without a single line of dialogue. Yeah. Super complex cast of characters. Right on. Good job, Stan. Still, a shallow cast of characters can sometimes be forgiven if they're being used in service of a greater story or a deeper message. Do we get either in this film? Well, almost. Maybe Kubrick and friends thought they had something deep to say about how war is hell, and the people on either side are both essentially as human and monstrous as each other. But those ideas aren't really explored in much depth beyond what I just said. The neatest thing about the whole story is that it's not really specified where or when it takes place. The main soldiers have American accents, but we're explicitly told from the beginning that they're not necessarily from any real country.
These soldiers that you see keep our language and our time, but have no other country but the mind.
Furthermore, the actors playing the soldiers also end up playing the enemy officers later in the film. Probably partly because Kubrick couldn't afford more than 5 actors, but it still works in favor of the message they're going for. The whole film is set up in this way to make it feel more like a story about war as a concept than about any one specific war. Jeffrey Cox, in his book The Wolf at the Door, described it as a film outside history, almost mythological in nature.
This forest then, and all that happens now, is outside history. Only the unchanging shapes of fear and doubt and death are from our world.
I don't know if I'd go so high and lofty as all that. Not when the acting, the editing, and the writing all feel so amateurish so much of the time.
But you can still see the ambition there, at least. The ambition that's going to lead to the actual lofty heights Kubrick reaches later in his career.
Son, wait! What's going to hang from the trees tonight?
Hurry with them.
No dying in the woods?
No rabbits, sir. No.
Maybe I'm getting old.
Faster!
Turn on the lights, please!
I'm sinking in the woods.
Don't die here!
I'm scared.
Dark will be
all
dead.
All right, turn them on, please!
Anyway, you don't need me to tell you that Fear and Desire isn't Kubrick's best film. Kubrick himself can tell you that.
I totally failed to recognize what I didn't know about making films or anything, you know. So I got the film made, but it was very, very dull. And it had a few, you know, it had a few good moments in it, but with the exception of one or two of the actors, they were all terrible actors, and I knew nothing about directing any actors.
He was so embarrassed by it that the film never really resurfaced outside of occasional screenings or TV airings until 2012, when it finally saw a DVD and Blu-ray release. Because the copyrights expired, you can watch that whole release of the film here on YouTube. Should you, though? Well, that depends on how deep you want to get into Kubrick as a filmmaker. If you want to see where the legend got his start, or you just want to be reminded that everyone was a newbie at some point, then it's worth watching as a curiosity. It's short, too, only a little over an hour, so you can get through it quickly enough to satisfy that kind of curiosity. If you just want to stick to the greatest hits, though, then this is one that you can safely shuffle out of your to-watch pile. Again, there's some really nice compositions to see, and even a few good acting moments here or there, but mostly, Fear and Desire is all just a warm-up for things that are to come. We'll start to see the beginnings of that when we look at Kubrick's next film, Killer's Kiss.